2021, Wednesday, Tuesday rather. And of course, days are really cruising because I know that we are almost all of us recovering from the political fatigue, of course, moods we're in, and slowly getting there and wanting to see what is available for you, more especially the young people that woke up in the morning on the 12th of August to go and cast their votes, for, of course, for your various political party leaders. But above all, it is on record that it is only Bali who is fully in charge of your affairs now. And the reason why we decided to play that clip, remember that in the run-up to the 2021 August elections, there were so many players that, of course, contributed immensely to the peaceful elections, or peaceful, of course, general elections that we've attended as a country. And among them, we had different, you know, civil society organizations that came on board as well. I know that for the sake of a debate, we had a lot of CSOs that came on board. Others were, of course, for the ruling party. Others, of course, were against, although people don't like saying against, but they were against the ruling party. But there were other individuals that, for them, they said they were not for or against, but they were just on the middle, meaning they were neutral. And one of such organizations is, of course, the Operation Young Vote, which is being presided by Guest Nyirenda as executive director of this institution. And they went, you know, in various parts of the country, in the outskirts, educating the young people, the youth, on the need and the importance of them voting. So really, it was a combination of that, you know, the rhythm where you, if you wanted, you just wake up and begin to dance. But above all, the content, it is what was very important, because it was urging young people to know their rights to vote and why it is important for them to vote. And finally, the peace of the country, which we have demonstrated for so many years now, from independence until now, Zambia, we've lived as a peaceful nation, of course, which is being admired by several nations in the world. So that was attained, very important in that song. We are away from that politics now. We want to find out what is available for the young people under the new Dawn administration of President Hakainde Hichilema and his alliance partners. My guest on the program is Guest Nyirenda, coming from the Operation Young Vote. Let's find out. He now comes to just add on his voice regarding what, of course, Bali has packaged so far or unveiled in terms of the cabinet ministers, and of course his speech to parliament. And also just 2 days ago, he was addressing the newly appointed cabinet ministers and provincial ministers. Of course, so many, you know, words were spoken, tough words were spoken to those cabinet ministers. Let's find out what Mr. Nyirenda depicted from that those are events. Mr. Nyirenda, welcome to this special interview on Movie TV.
Well, Comrade Innocent, IP, yeah, it's my one of my greatest failures, I may call it. I'm honored to be here.
Yeah.
I'm humbled. And indeed, and a lot of expectations out there.
Yeah.
And I think the election fatigue and mood is slowly, you know, drifting away, and we need now to get into gear in terms of what is there for development. Thank you so much for hosting me and for hosting Operation Young Vote, and we shall do due diligence to the topic so that our expectations are going to be the expectations of the people out there.
All right. Early in the day, when you confirmed about your presence here, of course, my producer Mokto Piri did justice by, advertising your post just to inform the nation of your coming. Now, guess what? You know,
talk to me.
We received a lot of questions, and people were asking, "What should we guess?" Because the person coming is Guest Nyirenda.
No, what they should guess is the fact that, of course, right now we have a new government, we have the new Dawn UPND Alliance administration, And we need to put them on their toes for them to do what we expect as a people. This is not the time to sleep. This is not the time to fold our arms. This is the time to begin to remind those that we have given the responsibility and the privilege to preside over our resources to do what, as Zambians, we expect. Remember that it is the young people that brought into existence or into being this government. And this government must be alive to the plight of young people, because if they don't, they risk being, you know, written off in a very short space of time. Of course, there are innuendos, there are thoughts that they, well, because of what is happening, they may be there forever. In Zambia, it doesn't happen like that. Zambia has a different ballgame when it comes to the elections and the electoral process. You may think that you own the people, but at the end of the day, the people will show you that they actually own you and power belongs to them. So the new Dawn administration has started on a very good note. If you get back to what has happened in the events that you alluded to, just his acceptance speech, Bali was so clear. Bali was, you know, emphatic, and he did not miss his words. Okay, for him it was, we need to unite the country, and unity begins by, we need to forgive each other. Of course, forgiving each other as brothers and sisters, as citizens, but remember that the law has no eyes. The law does not forgive. First of all, the law needs to walk its lane. It needs to go its route, and when it does its route, then that's when it forgives. So if there are those that made mistakes in the past, they must face the wrath of the law. This is the law that they put in place themselves. This is the law that they defended themselves. So they must test what this law is all about. So he started on that note of forgiveness, the note of unity, the note of working together, which is very good. Okay? And this is when we saw even other stations like Prime TV come on the scene, and they started operating. And I think the country just had a sigh of relief. The country had fresh air, for lack of a better term. From there, we saw many different things happen. The president was able to appoint the minister of finance. We saw things begin to change. The dollar kwacha rate, if you remember, it was at somewhere around just leaving the 22s, the range of 22, 21, 90, and today it's at 16, getting into the 15s. And I think this we need to applaud as a country. And many things, began to unfold. Of course, there were cries that cabinet was coming in too slow, but I think the time to be able to scan through who he thinks or who he thought would add value. You know, these appointments, these positions are not positions where you can just appoint anyhow and anyone. You must have your eyes opened. You must be able to see and scrutinize who can add value. Remember, his stance has been, you need to be qualified. Okay, you need to have the experience, but you need to have the qualification. So you don't have the qualification, forget about it. Look at the issue of cadres in markets, cadres in bus stations. I think thing of the past. And I think citizens are beginning to get happy. But this does not mean that we should be complacent and begin to fold our arms and say all is well. No, all is not well. So things are still being, you know, looked at. Things are changing slowly, but we shouldn't just take it for granted that because things are changing, then we fold our arms as civil society. We must have our eyes opened, our ego's eye. It must be open so that we can be able to see and scan everything that is happening around the country, so that where things are wrong, we must be able to point to those things and say, this is wrong, and we don't expect as a country to move in this direction. And then these leaders must be taken to account. Mind you, of course, now he has given us his cabinet, provincial ministers there. Well, some of them people are happy, others people have questions. I mean, it's normal in a democratic dispensation. It's normal where they are human beings. We need to question some of the things that need clarity, and clarity must be given. So we really are quite happy with what is happening. I think even just the kind of, you know, governance, things have changed a little bit, okay? And of course, we are seeing that hope has been restored. You know, the worst of things that can happen to a people, to a nation, is when you completely diminish their hope. And in the past regime, the PF regime, Zambians were losing hope, had lost hope. Zambians were actually going to the tail end of the hope that they had in a system or in leadership.
Let me just chip in one or two questions before I get to find out as to what you think made Zambians to lose hope in the Patriotic Front that led them vote the PF out of office. You've mentioned something very important about the minister that have been ushered into offices, and also the new ministries that have been created. We also have others that have been realigned. I want to get your thoughts. There's been a lot of inputs, like you've mentioned. Others are against certain individuals, certain faces, which we accommodate, because when we are in a democratic nation like ours, of course, there must be divergent views and also different opinions. What is yours? Having scanned through all the faces and the names of the people that have been appointed by Bali so far, what could be your analysis and your position so far?
Well, first things first, I think we must agree and appreciate that the UPND and Bali are not coming in this government as a lone entity, as the UPND. They are coming into this government as
a collection,
yeah. or whatever you may call it. It is the UPND alliance.
Right.
Remember, this was formed before the elections. Mm-hmm. And of course, even when they were forming this alliance, there were agreements here and there. Yeah. And it's normal to have agreements, because the main idea, the whole thing, mm-hmm. was actually to save the Zambian people from the destitution that they were subjected to by the Patriotic Front. It was to save the Zambian people from the autocratic and heavy-handed hand by the Patriotic Front. It was to save the Zambian people from the corruption and the hunger. I mean, these things are all over for all of us to see. They are in the open. Unfortunately, the PF became a government of a few people.
Yeah.
And this is why, for the very first time, you see that the margin between the winner and the runners-up, who was the incumbent, is 1 million votes. I mean, that's not a joke. People had decided, people were fed up with the corruption, with the lies, with the deceit. People were sleeping on money, people were getting rich, when the majority of the citizens in this country were going to bed on a hungry stomach, were going to bed, look, without nothing. I think people felt this was enough and they needed change. So, of course, now they came, they got together in that marriage of an alliance, And of course, like I said, there should have been agreements. Mm. And because of those agreements, we see now the alliance partners also coming into play in terms of cabinet. Mm. Now, first of all, Felix Mutati, yeah. Given the Minister of Science and Technology.
Yeah.
My own opinion is that, first of all, Felix Mutati is a good gentleman. He's a great guy. He's a great man. He has what it takes. He has the acumen. He has the experience. He has the expertise. And, I mean, he can make the very fair and good contributions.
In the very ministry?
I mean, anywhere you can place him. Anywhere you can place him. However, I think he has you know, been there for long. Of course, he's president of you know, of where he's coming from, and he comes into the alliance, and he needs to be rewarded,
yes.
And it's good to reward people that contribute. However, I think he has run his race, and you know, we need to begin to ensure that the people that have run their race, you know, they are in the background to advise. I mean, he can be given something else where he can actually even play a more critical role in terms of advising, not only being minister in that particular ministry, but also advising in commerce, advising in finance, and so on and so forth. And he would get what he wants at the end of the day. But of course, people need titles of minister of so and so. So for me, that would be my take. Mm-hmm. However, for now,
it's without any diplomacy really coming from you, would you say maybe he was wrongly placed on that?
No. For me, he was not wrongly placed.
Okay.
What I am saying is that he has run his race. Okay, so if he was placed under finance, or he was placed in commerce, even in that strategic ministry of science and technology, I mean, they are going to work as a collective. They are going to work as one. Okay, it's fine. Except that, of course, I mean, he has done his part. He was there in the MMD, he was there in the Patriotic Front, and today he's here in the UPND. We know it's being strategic to be where, you know, the winning
power is.
Yeah. It's being strategic, which is good, but I think we must begin to reach a point where we say, okay, you in this area, I think in being minister, I think you have done your part. You can even get more if it means it's a payment or whatever. You can get more as an advisor behind the scenes so that you are able to advise these. We needed young people to come on the scene on that particular point. However, when you come to other portfolios, okay, ministries, I think a good job has been done. The president did a commendable job. We know that there were very few young people that were elected in this election, but those that were elected, a good number of them have been given, you know, strategic ministries, and I will go one after the other. Ministry of Tourism, Arts and Culture, we have a young man, Rodney Sikumba. Rodney Sikumba comes with serious experience and expertise in the tourism sector. This is a young man who has been heading the Livingstone Tourism Association, okay? And I think almost all things to do with tourism, he was there. I remember when we, as a National Governing Council of the Africa Peer Review Mechanism, when we're doing the research in terms of the contribution of the tourism sector to our national economy, he was there. He has been there. So he understands the sector, and he has the experience. He's a young man, he has the energy, and he can do it. Already, if you see the program that he has lined up, it shows you that this is a person who is thinking, this is a person who has all the ideas in this area, and this is a person who the sector trusts. So you need somebody who the sector holds in high esteem, and that is him in that particular area. So that is a plus. When we come to the Ministry of Justice, we have a young man again, fairly young, Mlambo Haimbe. Mambo Haimbe is one of the renowned counsels in this country, or lawyers, if you like. He's one of those that has followed up the issues of human rights and justice, constitutional law, and all these things. He's somebody who has been tested, even if he has not been in government before, but he has the experience and the expertise that you need. He's fairly young, he has the energy, he can run the race. Already he's doing what needs to be done there. When you come to Cornelius Mwitwa, Southern Province, he's a young man that when he stands up to debate, you would really feel that, yes, Zambia is blessed with young people that understand issues. When he stands up in parliament, you would even feel, yes, we have a parliament. But when others stand up, sorry, it is a sight that is so worrying that you may even want to switch off your TV if you're watching on TV. But when Cornelius stands up, I think there's a lot that you would want to learn. He's been given Southern Province. He's been in Southern Province as Member of Parliament in Choma, I think, for 10 years. Yeah. Now this is the 15th, or the third year term, or whatever you can call it. Yeah. He has the experience. He has what it takes to lead the province. We have a young man, Stanley Kakuo, Member of Parliament, Kapirin Poshi, given the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. The young man is he knows stuff. He may not be, he may not know exactly or issues critically in the ministry, but he's a young man who is ready to learn. He's one of those that we have worked with in the background. Remember when there was that issue of the Bush protest? When the young men or the young people of this country went to the bush to protest and did the police a don't kubeba, okay, an application was sought, it was granted. The 11th hour, the police said, no, we can't, because of political influence from the Patriotic Front. And that was the time when Bowman Lusambu was saying the young people are too naked to advise the head of state. They have no acumen, they have no knowledge, they have nothing to advise the head of state. Here it is. The head of state has been advised and kicked out of office by the very young men who Bowman Lusambu and his cohort thought that the young people could not advise the president. They were too naked. So look at how the president has paid the price because of some of these people that he was appointing. Right. Okay, so Stanley Kakubo was with us. We met in the background. We actually did together the statement that we wanted him to do in parliament, so that they could censure Bowman Lusambu and stop playing around with the young people. Okay, and that was done. So for us, these are young people who have a background. These are young people who have come from somewhere. Of course, young people have raised eyebrows on the appointment of the Minister of Youth, LVC Nkandu. Of course, he's got experience in his own right, and we must respect that. He is a mobilizer, but young people are complaining. We have already been mobilized. We don't want a mobilizer anymore. We want somebody who is going to address our issues as it were. And I'll come and discuss some of the issues in the plight to do with the plight of, sure, the youth and in the Ministry of Youth, when you allow me.
Let me write on that aspect of your submission. I know that you're among those organizations that went out there to educate young people through the voter education, from the clip that we just from showing. What is it that you wanted on behalf of the young people? Because you are heading an organization which is of young people. What is it that you were advocating which you didn't see in the Patriotic Front administration?
Well, first of all, we thank all those that helped us with resources to go out there and engage with the young people, educate them on very pertinent issues of national significance. The American Embassy in Zambia, the United Nations Development Program, they really did help, came to the aid of young people through Operation Young Vote for them to receive this kind of education. Now, the challenge that we had in the Patriotic Front was that the young people were not considered anymore. And this is why you saw those numbers of young people. If you went to any polling station that time, there were huge numbers. Imagine one would be the first person in the queue or on the queue would be here in movie TV, and the last person would be somewhere in arcades. And people never minded to say, I'm number 2,000. To them, they didn't care. All they wanted was they needed to vote. And they needed to vote this regime or that regime that was so toxic out. That regime had no regard for the young people. When we told them, we were called, no, you are supporting the opposition. They wanted those who sang praises for them. They wanted those they supported on Bulten. That's who they wanted and they respected. But today, unfortunately, there are those they wanted and they supported have gone under. We don't know where they are. Okay? But the issue is that they had no regard whatsoever for the young people. The only young people, and a few of them, were just within the cadres of you know, the Patriotic Front. And a lot, and I'm saying a few of them, my brother, a few of them, IP, a lot of the PF young people were coming to us to complain. This is what this government and our party is doing to us. Some of the things that we were raising were coming from within the Patriotic Front because people were annoyed. Okay, there were only a few cliques, a few cadres who would be given money. Can you go and sleep on this money on your bed? Can you go and put this money on the tarmac and mock the Zambian people? And that's exactly what they did. And there was nothing for the genuine young people. There was no empowerment, nothing whatsoever. It is at the tail end when they were almost exiting power that they wanted to begin now to throw money to all the young people. They bring the tankers, they bring this, they bring this. Remember that we had the issue of Higer buses in this country. Yeah. Up to today, the PF failed to explain that issue of Higer buses. Yeah. Even now, they will not explain to you, especially that they are even out of power. We don't know what explanation they are going to give. Mm-hmm. And when we confronted them, when we talked about this, they called us. We were opposition. We were siding with you. No, we were siding the people of Zambia because the monies and the resources that you used to purchase those buses.
You were siding the people of Zambia through the opposition.
No. Through our own organizations. Okay? When we speak what we speak, we just speak it because that is the right thing and the right way to go. So they had no regards for the young people. We tried our level best. And one of the things that we raised in the Patriotic Front regime, apart from the issue of empowerment, was the issue of the Ministry of Youth. And we hope and pray that this government will begin to listen about this issue or to this issue. If they don't, I don't know. The Zambian young people will decide. And the Zambian young people have been crying that, look, the merging or the putting together of the Ministry of Youth together with sport is not good and is not helpful. It failed us in the MMD. It failed us in the PF. And if the UPND continues with it, it will fail us. And I will explain so that we all are on one page. The Ministry of Youth is being obscured by the sports element of the ministry. Now, the sports component of the ministry does not deal with all sport, it only deals with soccer. So when a minister goes there as Minister of Youth and Sport, the only interest they have, or the only focus they have for them to make a name quickly, is to go to football. Not to sport, football. Today, the UPND must open their eyes. Today, the Minister of Youth is under serious attack by citizens, by the young people, because he has gone to FAS and he is indicating that he needs certain people to come back to FAS, so that already he has spoiled his game already. Now, we are saying, look, the Ministry of Youth must be a standalone ministry. It should only be called Ministry of Youth. So that remove the sport, and if you want, you can create another ministry to call it Ministry of Sport and Recreation. Because the way things are and the way things have been, it is like sport and youth are synonymous. No, sport and youth are not synonymous. The youth of this country, who are a heterogeneous group, has a lot of needs. Youth need empowerment. Youth need entrepreneurship. Youth need education. Youth need a lot of things. And also they need sport. But why should sport be elevated and not entrepreneurship? Why should sport be elevated and not empowerment? This is what we are saying. So if we are going to make a difference, and there will be something that we are going to actually record that we have made an impact, we must leave the Ministry of Youth as a stand-alone ministry, so that the person that goes there as Minister of Youth, first of all, must comprehend with youth matters. Unfortunately, it looks like the minister currently does not comprehend with youth matters. Why? Because already straight he goes to sport and he goes to FAS, and it's all over on Facebook. He's under serious attack because Zambians have realized, he wants to bring confusion in FAS, because he wants to bring the names which we may not need to mention here.
Yeah.
So that is a problem. But if we are going to have a person who is going to comprehend with youth matters, they will understand the needs and the plight of the youth. That it does not only deal with sport, it has to deal with empowerment, it has to deal with entrepreneurship, it has to deal with young people being in agriculture, it has to deal with small and medium scale businesses, and so on and so forth. Then we'll begin to coordinate the ministry very well. Then we will mainstream all the youth issues in all ministries, including the sports component, because then we'll have given this youth component what it deserves. I expected the Minister of Youth, the first thing he should have done was, first of all, to go to the National Youth Development Council, NYDC. Now, NYDC today is thriving on an act that is a 1986 act. Count how many years it is today back to 1986. We are still in UNIP, for heaven's sake. And how do you deal with youth matters when the act, the law that you are using is still in UNIP? When did UNIP leave power? We had MMD, the Chiruba MMD. We had Mwanawasa MMD. We had the Rupia Banda MMD. We had the Patriotic Front, Michael Sata. We had Edgar. And today we are in the UPND. Why should we continue on that archaic law? This is what we expected the minister to do. It is youth that is paramount. It is not only the youth that play sport. It is the old madalas, the children, and that's why sport should be removed and put alone elsewhere, somewhere with recreation, so that youth can have serious concentration on what we need to be done in that.
I know the passion, Mr. Nyirenda, you have. I can see it in your face, the way you are speaking. You know, the passion you have for the young people, because I think the other, souls you are. You want to save, you want to advance. But of course we've had administrations, for example the Patriotic Front, when it was in government, they did preach that I think if there is a government that performed better in addressing the plights of young people, there will be no any better administration apart from the PF, because you can talk about the youth empowerment that they brought about, according to them as well. You can't surpass them in terms of the jobs that they created during their tenure in office. Of course, although they couldn't count in total how many jobs they created, but according to them, they said, I think it was massive. Hence, the counting was very difficult for them. You know, again, we've got the UPND administration under Bali, who has promised to create jobs for the young people. All right, through, of course, the Minister of Youths and Sports as well. Why should we discuss all these, you know, achievements that might have taken place?
IP, look, the truth of the matter is that whatever jobs the PF created, we can't see them. Okay, if young people got jobs because they created a district, well and good, they were obliged. But I think beyond the young people that get into these very minimal number of jobs that are in government, we expect a leadership, a government that would create an environment that is conducive for the private sector to thrive. Okay, the private sector failed to thrive during the PF, and if I mean they get 2, 3, 4, or 20 young people and tell them, can you cut grass here, and they count that as job creation, that is not job creation. Those are small pieceworks. The young people will knock off with 20 kwacha each, they go home, what job have you created? Young people expect pensionable jobs, where at the end of the day, when they retire, they have a pension. We have people that go to parliament, and when people leave parliament, they have gratuity. They have millions and billions of money, taxpayers' money. We want young people to also get something from the coffers of the country at the end of the day when they retire from their jobs. So you can't talk about cutting grass along the road to say this is job creation. No, it's not. It's not. So we expected better from...
They'll tell you that young people are employed in the construction sector, for example.
Which construction sector? Which construction sector? Which the construction sector today, they have a job tomorrow because they can't pay a contractor. There's nothing happening tomorrow. No, it's not that we are talking about. We are talking about something that is sustainable, so that the people will know that for the next 20, I'll be eating, I'm comfortable. As long as I am working, I'll be able to get something and take home. Not what we were seeing. In fact, even under this regime, and why the PF failed in terms of creating a conducive environment, is that because, you know, they were so greedy, those people. I've never seen a greedy group like that group of PF. They were so greedy. Greedy in the sense that they were even competing for businesses with small businesses of young people. You empower a young person, can you do this business? Instead of allowing that young person to grow in that business by making them supply their services or their goods to government, you have the same ministers competing with them supplying to government. That is what was happening in this Ghosn regime. And you can't, they were the ones who were, you know, constructing, doing what, everywhere. It was no young person who was genuine and who was innocent like your name from just Kalingalinga or from any other place benefited. And this is why people said, this is enough. We can't have a few clique of people. Yesterday they had nothing. Tomorrow they are the richest in the world. We can't, because the resources that they are having to make them rich are the resources of this country. And the country needs to share this cake equitably. All of us must be able to say, wadiyako waka, wadiyako waka, wadiyako. And look, this is what we are praying Bali and his administration must do. Right. In terms of youth empowerment, when you give young people whatever empowerment you are giving them, first of all, train them. You are giving them money, train them how to handle that money. Okay? You are giving them tankers. People were given tankers, my brother. They didn't know what to do with those tankers. People were given Higer buses. They didn't know what to do with those Higer buses because they were just dumped. Okay, youth empowerment. So that they show the world and the unsuspecting citizens that they were doing something. Unfortunately, they were not. So we expect that this government will do things differently. And we demand that they do things different. For example, if they are going to empower 2,000 young people, as an example, and they say, okay, we are going to give these young people this amount of money. You want to do business in rearing chickens. You want to do business in supplying stationery. You want to do business, and they, you know, they empower these 2,000 young people. What they must do is that they must have a policy as a government that we will buy 50% of the services and the goods of these young people for the next 1 year. So that we, number one, we make them grow in business, but secondly, we keep them in business so that they are sustained. So that at the end of the year, 1 year, because government is buying, you are assured of market when you supply to government. Okay? And because government is buying, then these young people will be sustained. And at the end of the day, you will win them off. They will graduate to another level. Then they will be able to pay back that money that you gave them. The startup capital, they will be able to retain it, pay it back. And you will get that money and give to another group of 2,000 young people. There you are developing the country. But where you are saying, oh, you are just giving your cadres, sleep on this money, sleep on this money. They get the money and splash it on the bed and now start insulting those that, all the Zambians, you are poor, you are foolish, you are what? And you expect that the people will be kind to you and retain you in power. No, Bwana. They will not, because nawe vichiba baba. The resources that this country has must be shared. So if you have such kind of a plan, it means that every year you are winning off 2,000 young people. They graduate to another level. And they are becoming big businessmen, just like that.
On the same aspect, before we get away from this advocacy for the young people, I know that you've got too much passion for the young people.
And I will not stop.
Right.
I will not stop. I know that.
I thought maybe by now you've achieved what you wanted.
No.
Possibly.
Achieving
you
is.
You have to go home and sleep.
No. Achieving is when we see that the resources we begin to equitably, you know, share these resources to everyone. The young people of this country, the ones that made a difference, the ones that put in this new dawn government, the ones that put Bali in power. Bali must reciprocate by bringing in serious policies and legislation that will support young people. So that is the only way we are going to create employment. That is the only way we are going to create empowerment, rather than cheating young people and hoodwinking them because you have money to splash around and think that these praise singers now will sing your praises and to end there. No. Empower the young people, then you will see that people will sit down and say, this is a working government.
I want to take you to the fight against corruption. But before that, just under a minute, what are some of the critical or terrible mistakes that were made under the PF government or administration, which you don't want Bali and his government to do that or to commit that? Just under a minute, we go to the fight against corruption.
Well, the first one is what I was just alluding to,
yeah.
The issue of neglecting and ignoring the young people and think that you will ignore them forever. You can't. So that is one of the grave mistakes that the PF made. Today, I'm sure they are regretting. They are licking their wounds today for insulting young people, that young people were too naked to advise the head of state. Today, they are in the state of confusion because of what they thought. They thought they were too clever. There's no one, even myself, I'm not too clever. No, there's no one who is too clever for the next person. We are all the same, and we must respect each other in that light. The other thing that this government made was they were not listening to anyone. The PF stopped listening. When we spoke, we were called names. Oh, some of us were even say, you are foolish, you are from the East and the president is from the East. Why are you? It's not about coming from one region. It's about doing what is right. Some of us stood for what is right. Even in this regime, we shall stand for what is right, regardless of who comes from where. We are all Zambians. So if you make a mistake and say, no, as an Invera Chifundo, because we come from together or we come from the same area, forget it. We shall be on your nose and we shall be just by you to tell you, look, you can't do this particular thing. So the PF stopped listening to anyone. The PF, unfortunately, they brought in aspects, they divided this country. It is the PF that was preaching tribalism. And they wanted to lump it on Haka in the Hichilema. And that's what they were doing. And they thought they would succeed. Unfortunately, God does not operate like that. Are you hearing today? Are you hearing the tribalism we're hearing when the PF was in power? It's not there. If it was Haka Indi who was promoting it, why is he not even escalating it now? Because he has the instruments of power. But because it is clear that they were just lumping it on him, and they went around the country and said, no, you can't bring Omutonga, you can't, no, we are all
Zambians. We have to end this interview, but my last question, I think, is on the fight against corruption, of course, that we talked about already, but there are people, of course, people like you that have hinted already to say, if there are people that store public resources, they have to pay back, and yet Bali is saying, we have to forget, it's not about no revenge or whatever, we have to move on like that. You know, let's talk about forgive and forget in line with the Bible. Should we maybe forgive people that allegedly, I'm still using alleged because we are not sure up to now who stole how much money and who stole people's money. Should we forgive these people?
It is the Bible that says forgive and forget. Okay. It is the same Bible that says, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. So those that got from Caesar, who is Zambia and the nation, should give back to Zambia and the nation, which is Caesar. Look, Bali is a human being, just like me. Bali is not the law. Underline that. Bali is the president, yes, with due respect. But he is not the law. He will forgive, okay, forgive, but the law must take its course, Baba. It must.
Right.
Look, the Bible says, thou shalt not steal. It is the same Bible that says, thou shalt not steal. You steal, it is a sin. So all those that store, they must know that it is a sin to steal. And a sin is punishable.
Right.
So they must bring back. Look, they shouldn't even wait because people just got stinking rich overnight from nowhere. It's not possible. People must account. If they can't account, this in the Kenagula so, Nagula and Ramazan so, if they can't account, then we must grab all those things and forfeit to the state and punish them for having, for failing to account on the things that they have. So, Bali is human, is president, hands up, thumbs up, but he is not the law. The law must be implemented to the letter. Those that store must be followed, and we must recover. We welcome the fast track courts, and they must start working immediately. We shouldn't even waste time. Because look, these people were even mocking Zambians when they were stealing the monies from Zambians. So if they store, they must bring. If they didn't steal, the law will clear them that they didn't steal. Then we'll move and forgive each other.
Mr. Nyirenda, I know that you can talk the whole day. Already you can imagine we've taken an hour plus. We have to go. We have to go.
IP, I am grateful. Thank you so much. But we need to find more time to talk about these issues. It's not vindictiveness.
Yeah.
No, it's just asking that the law should take its course. Remember how them at that time. They were calling for the president to bring about, to invoke Article, is it 36, 32, to bring about the state of emergency, to do what? Because they had a mission. For us, it's not a mission of having them, you know, punished. It's a mission of recovering what belongs to Zambia. Give the Zambians what is theirs.
We have to go. Thank you so much for coming, Senor.
And by the way, the same money and resources, when they come, they will be used to empower the youth so that they have jobs and
thank
empowerment.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
My pleasure. Thank you so much.
Great. All right. Of course, my guest has been guest Nirenda, coming from the Operation Young Voter. Of course, he doesn't stop talking, so we have to get, you know, just through his throat and pause him later for the next interview that will come very soon. Thank you so much to my producer, Mavto Pire, and also the entire production team, Christopher in the studio. Thank you so much. Above all, like I always say, we give that credit to you, the viewers, that have been sending those questions and also contributions through our social media page. Thank you so much. Your viewership is valued always. My name is Innocent Piri, IP. Allow me to say, may God bless Zambia. May God bless Mother Africa. Good night.